Now, historically, the African National Congress's Youth League has played the role of kingmaker in the politics of the governing party. But that was then. Now the organization is in tatters and suffers a host of challenges and simply cannot get its act together to even hold an elective conference to get a new leadership elected. This raises questions as to its very existence, its role and impact. To unpack the role of the African National Congress Youth League and that of young people in leadership more generally, I'm joined by the Young Communist League's Kgabo Morifi, also by Tholithembelihle Ngwenya, as well as Regotsefetse Chikane. He's a student activist at and political commentator. Thanks for joining me here in the studio. Sorry for that tongue twister, but let me get to you first, Ms. Ngwenya, and give you the opportunity to start. Do we still need a youth league? And if so, what exactly is its role? Given the fact that South Africa's population is overwhelmingly young, if you're organizing the people, you'll be organizing young people into the ANC. Why do they need a separate structure?
Just a reminder that the reason why the ANC Youth League was formed was to ensure that we rally young people to want to form part of the ANC. And that is what compromises one of the twin tasks of the ANC, which is rallying young people to form part of the ANC and also to ensure that we further their interests. As you have said, we have a large population of young people who are facing a number of issues such as unemployment. So it's important that the ANC is at the forefront of advocating for those issues. It cannot be that the ANC is left out of the conversation and there's almost a vacuum that's left there when it's issues that are in relation to young people. Because if we're to be honest, if we look at the ANC itself, the people that fill up the ranks of the ANC are people that don't necessarily relate to young people. Young people don't resonate with the people who are leading in the structures of the ANC. So the role of the ANC Youth League is then to come in and ensure that that vacuum is filled and that young people are found part of that conversation in terms of shaping their future and what needs to happen moving forward.
Mr. Chikane, do you share that view?
Not necessarily. So we were actually talking backroom. I fundamentally think the ANC Youth League needs to be honest with itself, and its members need to be honest. So forget the leadership, forget the people who are reforming the party now, who aren't ANC Youth League members anyway. But the idea that you have to burn it all down to start again, right? Fundamental reforms in the party that change the organizational culture of the party, right? It's the idea that what ANC Youth League branch at a local level gets involved in community service-based work. Right, that should be a prerequisite, that you can't be a branch of the ANC if you're not involved in the community. The ANC Youth League seems to talk about young people, but doesn't do anything actively for young people day to day.
Okay, it's that changing culture. Let me bring you in here. Many people have argued that the push to have a youth league is simply just the ability to create another structure with which to wield influence and to access patronage. If young people want to be involved in the African National Congress, why just not join a branch?
Look, I think, Karima, let me take you back to, you know, the founding of the Youth League, because you have had, you know, young people like O.R. Tambo's, Anthony Limbedes and them, who were a generation of young people, but they did not only see themselves as the future leaders of the ANC, but they also, they also saw themselves as leaders. Now, what is a challenge at the current moment, Karima, is that young people have, you know, neglected the role of being leaders themselves and have given this role to patrons in the form of bishops, and to a great extent this is what is causing problems, because the reality of the matter is that, Karima, a strong and vibrant ANC Youth League is a legitimate problem to the ANC. That is why
but can the current ANC, Ms. Ngwenya, give rise to a youth league that is not plagued by the very same divisions that its mother body is being plagued by? I mean, the organization is rent down the middle.
I think if we were to be honest and introspect, like the comrade on the left is saying, the politics of the ANC Youth League are largely influenced by politics of the ANC. And for as long as at the center of the ANC is material benefits and patronage network, as Comrade Kgabo has said, it's going to have a direct impact on the ANC Youth League. The ANC Youth League then almost ceases to have its own autonomy. Mm-hmm. And that's the case right now, is that we want to have a vibrant ANC Youth League that is addressing issues of young people. But at the center of it all is that their handlers, who have certain political interests and are using certain youth attachments to achieve whatever interests they may have. And that is at the core of our problem.
Talking about people being members of members, we saw, for example, two former Youth League presidents having to run for their lives, Fikile Mbalula and Malusi Kgabo recently in Limpopo. We saw the killing of an ANC Youth League leader recently. And I asked the question, why did people go with guns to a rally of the ANC Youth League? I mean, doesn't that actually just epitomize the bankruptcy of those who see themselves as the inheritors of that generational mix? And doesn't it reinforce the point that this is just a way to have a block of people that is basically up for hire?
Yep. So in my mind, I think, again, I'll double down on changing the organizational culture of the party. When I say burn it down, it's not some, it must never come back ever again, right? It's the idea that you have to fundamentally ask the question of who do you want leading you in the next 30 years? The reforms that you do in the ANC Youth League, if you do fundamental reforms and you change
such
the culture,
as?
Right, such as one member, one vote, right? Getting rid of the delegate system that essentially opens up patronage networks, asking the questions of every branch has to do community service-based work so that you're in touch with your communities. Fundamental reforms like that, if you do that in the Youth League, can carry on as we get older. If we allow our older parents and generations to dictate how the ANC Youth League should be, then we can't blame anyone but ourselves for such.
Mr. Morifi, I see you nodding your head.
Look, I think one of the things that we have not really dealt with, the existential crisis within the ANC itself. Going to Polokwane, there is a discussion around two centers of power, which are, in my view, is a fundamental, you know, pillar that gave rise to this opportunism.
But sorry to interrupt you there. This discussion of two centers of power, a young person walking in the street can't relate to what you're saying. You're essentially speaking to cadres of an organization that has no real life experience to young people.
Yes.
Listen, Gwenya, you want to come in here?
I do agree with you that as an organization, we tend to talk at people and assume that the community understands languages and lingo such as two centers of power. And that's how easily we lose relevance, because we're not willing to break these concepts down to the community that we actually
need. So let me put it to you. There's been a push to say that let's not send delegates that you can buy, that you can use money to gatekeep the African National Congress. Let every member of the ANC have a vote. Would you say that if you reconstitute the Youth League, that is how the new leadership of the Youth League should actually be voted in? That you shouldn't have delegates coming to a conference, but whoever is a member of the Youth League must have the right to vote for its leadership.
I understand the advantages of making that kind of change, but I'm not sure it will prevent the issue of buying people to forward a certain view.
But won't it make it more democratic?
Of course, theoretically it will come across if it's more democratic. But in relation to, if we look at our socio-economic context in South Africa, is that a person in the community will only be willing to further a certain view if, unfortunately, directly benefits them. We can't take that away from the discussion. Yes, they are members of the ANC Youth League. Yes, it will be more democratic. But their views can be swayed by whatever material benefit that they're going to receive at the end of the day, whether they're a member of the Youth League, whether they're a delegate. I don't think the change in terms of who they are will actually then change at the core in terms of the patronage and what is going on.
Do you agree?
So I think to an extent, but you get rid of that problem by secret ballot, right? If it's the idea that no one will know where your vote goes, then you never need to worry that I'm going to tell this person that if you give me a loaf of bread, I'll vote your way. But if the person can't guarantee that you voted their way, they'll never give you that loaf of bread. A secret ballot. In my mind, the ANC Youth League in particular is using 20th century forms of politics and ideology for a 21st century problem. And until we merge those two views together in one way or another, we'll be stuck.
Kgabo, the whole idea that you need a Youth League to energize an ANC that needs to talk to a young populace, I mean, the majority of people who are eligible to vote in this country is young, is already giving you a headache, right? and of course, the fact is money is an issue. I mean, you have people that are in positions of power, young people that have never worked a day in their lives, but they're millionaires. They step off the student campus as millionaires because they sit on committees that decide on construction. corruption, on security companies and so on. How do you stop that? How do you stop the capture of young people to moneyed interests in the party?
I wouldn't necessarily say it's a question of political, you know, education, because even those that have went to exile are people who are currently, you know, in courts or trying to defend themselves of corruption cases. So there's something really about society that we need to really do much of our work into, concept more efforts into, you know, strengthening your utilitarian value system in society, to try and embed, you know, a culture, I mean, a deification of private wealth, for example, is a problem, wherein young people get to, you know, praise those that, you know, wear flashy clothes, designer labels, fast cars, smoke cigars, get, you know, expensive alcohol and drinks, and as things that as young people wish to have access to, is deeply a problem within our movement. But the challenge of corruption is what is killing the movement, and is going to kill even the effort to rebuild the Youth League, if we're truly to be honest about it.
Now, the Young Women's Desk is trying to shake this mantle of the Women's League that always sacrifice gender issues at the altar of party loyalty. How successful are you really in being able to do that? Have you been able to mainstream the issues that young women face in society, given that they are in fact the majority?
I must say that I am a member of the Young Women's Desk, and my views might be considered to be a bit subjective, but according to my, and I've been in the organization for 5 years, and I feel the Young Women's Desk has successfully brought issues that are directly affecting women to the forefront. I think for the first time we're
But are you heard by older women in the organization?
Of course it's a bit of a struggle, because you understand that to have that intergenerational dialogue, they have their own views that they are used to, and that they're not willing to let go of that easily. And as young people, power won't just be handed over to us. We won't just shape discussions on the basis that we were allowed to. We need to be there shaking up the space and ensuring that these discussions are happening. For example, now we're discussing issues of the LGBTQIA+ for the first time in the ANC Women's League. And for me, that is a victory in itself. And the crisis with the MDM is that we don't own the victories. We don't own the narrative. Mm. What we have is the media then saying that we're not doing enough. Mm. Because when we are doing the work in the communities, as you had stated, we don't make people aware that this is what we're doing.
Yeah.
You get what I'm saying?
Mr. Chikane, let me just quickly bring you in. This idea that youth and progressiveness have an essential relationship is problematic for me. There's also a terrible ageism that is among young people who believe that they know everything, that nothing has come before them. Mm. How important is an intergenerational conversation in getting us to a new value system that can perhaps give rise to an organization with a different set of values that can meet today's challenges?
Yeah, so I stopped using the phrase intergenerational dialogue or conversation. I say it has to be an intergenerational debate, right? Because young people right now are the most vulnerable grouping in our society, right? One of the most. Of unemployment affects us the most, poverty affects us the most, that trifecta of inequality as well, right? So it's a question of, when we get into a room to have this discussion, it's not that we're being progressive, it is we're advocating on behalf of the most one of the most vulnerable groupings of society, and that's how we're entering this conversation. And we're entering this conversation to essentially say, the way we discussed things before can't go on, because we've seen the results before. And
well,
that's where
I wish you every success, and I hope your elders are listening. Thank you so very much for joining me. Yeah, up next, we take a look at the stories making headlines in the weekend newspapers. Stay tuned.